Hi, this is Pat Johnson, your psychology instructor, and in this mini lecture, we're going to talk about some basic principles in classical conditioning dealing with timing and order. And these are important. It's very brief, but these are important to remember as you work through understanding classical conditioning. So let's go back to our original example dealing with Pavlov's dog. And if you remember, what happens first is the condition stimulus, and then remember the condition stimulus is the bell. The bell used to be neutral, it used to be meaningless, but when the bell has been paired with the food enough times, and the food is the unconditioned stimulus, unconditioned meaning not learned, and food is, you don't have to learn that food causes salivation. Food causes salivation naturally in both dogs and humans, so salivation to food is an unconditioned response. Food is an unconditioned stimulus. So we have the bell coming first, add food, the food comes second, and then we have salivation that comes third. So bell plus food causes salivation. Bell plus food causes salivation. And do that enough times, and pretty soon the bell causes salivation. So salivation to the bell is a conditioned response. It looks just like the unconditioned response, but remember, conditioned means learned. So that's what happens last. So, what I want you to know is that the optimal interval between the conditioned stimulus and the unconditioned stimulus is about a half a second. In other words, you want it to go bell food, bell food. You want it to be a very short interval between the bell and the food. Think of if you had it for, let's say, a minute. You rang the bell. If you waited a minute and then the food came, well, that's way too long. The dog's not going to associate that bell with that food. A million other things have happened in the dog's environment probably in that time. So the optimal interval between the conditioned stimulus and the unconditioned stimulus is about a half a second for most instances of classical conditioning. The other thing we must remember is that the conditioned stimulus has to come before the unconditioned stimulus. The CS has to come before the US. And why is that important? Well, the CS predicts that the US is coming. Imagine if it was the other way around. Let's suppose we gave the dog the food first and then we rang the bell. Well, that bell would be meaningless in that case because the dog's already chowing down on the food. It can't work that way. The CS has to precede the US because the CS predicts that the US is coming. So again, CS, about a half a second later, we want the US to happen, and then the dog's going to salivate to the US. And do that enough times, and pretty soon that conditioned stimulus is going to cause a conditioned response.